What's up, everybody? Welcome back to Office Hours with the Professor, the show where I say things. Today, we're going to be looking at how to talk about our house and the things in our house in the Quechua language. And it's going to be really cool because we have lots of really cool traditional cultural items to talk about. So I hope that you'll join me for this exciting lesson. Before we get into today's lecture, I want to go over some feedback that I got the other day from one of my viewers. This viewer asked me to clarify the glottalized tone in Quechua. So this viewer asked, how does glottalization work in Quechua? I'm having a hard time producing this sound. That's a great question because English doesn't really glottalize words in the same way that Quechua does. Anyway. So glottalization in Quechua is basically a brief glottal stop while articulating a vowel. Now, what is a glottal stop? Okay, so a glottal stop is basically what we do down in here in our throat when we cut off the air very briefly. Now, how do we do that? How do we make a sound that's not in the mouth at all? Here's how. In English, we have an expression. We say, for no, right? So if someone says to me, hey bro, do you want to go out and vandalize some buildings and get arrested? I can say, right? And this kind of pause between the two sounds is, the glottis is the term, closing to just barely separate the two sounds. So if you want to work on your glottal stops, you can practice saying, making ridiculous propositions to yourself and then saying, right? Because that's what a glottal stop is. So let's practice some glottal stops in Quechua now, okay? Or some glottalized tone anyway. And remember, in Quechua, the glottal stop is very light, so it's less of and more of right? So it's much lighter maybe than we would use in English and maybe even than I'm saying. So let's practice. So of course the most, or one of the most common words that we'll hear in Quechua with a glottalized tone is meaning yes. Okay, and that I think that's a really good word for yes, right? So maybe if I'm talking in Quechua and I agree with you, I could say right? So I think that's a really good one to use. So just, maybe you can even bring this into your own life when you're agreeing with people and you're having conversations, you can respond to them by saying, and I'm pretty sure they'll get what you mean because this, I think, inherently has this yesness about it. Anyway, the word yes, not the band yes, although I do like the band. So, at is the word for bone in Quechua. And remember, we already talked about this, right? Your bones are your relatives or your clan in Quechua, right? And the third one is men, meaning breast, okay? And so these are some words that we can use to practice glottalization in Quechua. Let's move on to words with more than one syllable, okay? More than one syllable words, polysyllabic, multisyllabic words in Quechua are not strongly articulated with as far as tone goes. Okay, so if we're using the glottalized tone in Quechua, we're not really having a strong sound thereof. So for example, in the word mamuj, which literally means breast water, what do you think that means? It means milk in Quechua, right? So in mamuj, we're not really saying mamuj, which is what the tones are by themselves, but we're not doing that. We're just saying mamuj. The tone is really only wholly present in monosyllabic words. Moving on, today I want to talk about things that we find in the house, cultural objects, okay? And let's start, as always, with the brief context, right? We just made friends with a family of Ket people, and they're living along the banks of the Yenisei River, right? And we met them while they were setting up their spring encampment, okay? And now that their birch bark teepee is set up, they invite you in. And the air inside is smoky and warm, and you can distinguish a few important items belonging to the family, and not least among them, the family's guardian spirit dolls, which are very important in Ket culture. I'll do our dialogue, okay? I don't have a hat to play with this time, but I hope you can bear with me. And I'll do the dialogue, and please look at the bottom of the screen for the text to come up, okay? Ooh. Ögna kos ka achtas. Kutum. Eh. Quska usam. Ooh. Quska akususang. Kutum. Quska idna hoyang usang. Ooh. Kere hoyang akus. Kutum. Kere klerk hai suyet. Ture dahaning de kaat hai kere ap usam. Ooh. Tune akus. Kutum. Tune na alles hai dangles. Ukuska alles tam dangles usang. Ooh. Apkuska alles tam dangles bunsang. Okay. So hopefully you were able to follow along with not only my pointing to who's talking, but also the dialogue on the bottom of the screen. The subtitles, if you will. But at any rate, let's go over our grammar points for today. So here's our first grammar point. Now I know you can't see my face, but don't worry, I haven't been beheaded. So let's just go over our grammar. Our first point today is locative. Now what's locative? Here we have the word loc. Now maybe you speak Latin and you know that the word locus means place, or even in English we have the word location, right? So, or even in Spanish, lugar is place, I think, right? So that's easy to remember. So locative is talking about location or place. So saying where something is. And locative is used the same suffix with all nouns, the same postposition with all nouns, regardless of number of that noun or even the gender of that noun. Now, what is the locative postposition in Ket? Ka. It's very easy. All you need to do is take the thing where you are, the place where you are, and then add ka to the end. For instance, Quska, at home. Now, remember, the actual word kus is glottalized, but since this is a multi-syllable word, we aren't saying it as strongly, so I've actually taken it out here. So for instance, if I want to say I am at home, what would we do? Remember our word for I is at, so we could say at Quska, I'm at home. Now what if I'm not at home? What if I'm in the forest? I could say at Hiseka, because remember Hise is our word for forest, and we can say ka to say that we are there. So at huseka, I'm in the forest. And remember, this weird vowel here is a unrounded back high vowel. So that's hard for English speakers, but easy for Korean speakers, right? Okay, so anyway, at Quska, at huseka. Okay, good, good, good. So our next grammar point is discussing the presence of an item, a physical presence of an item at some location, okay? And in English, we usually say there is, there are, or there isn't, or there aren't, right? Or in Spanish, we could say I, or in Russian, we could say есть. This is a very important grammar point that all languages have, okay? So if we want to say for positive, this isn't a T, sorry, this is a positive, if there is something, in some location, we say usang, usang, okay? But if there is not something at a location, if we want to say there is or are not, we say bunsang, bunsong. And remember, bun is our word for no, right? So we can see where it comes from. Usang, bunsang. So there is not, there are not. Singular and plural are the same. So let's try a sentence. Quska tuin usang. Quska tuin usang. So even if we don't know what tuin is, and we know here because I wrote it down, we can say, we already know, in the house, right? Or in the birch bark teepee, usang. So, or at home, there is something. Now, what is a tuin? Tuin is kettle. So we use it, you know, for making tea and hot water and things. So I don't need to explain that to you. You know what a kettle is. Quska tuin usang. So there's a kettle at home. So this also is a fairly easy grammar point. Okay, so our last grammar point is going to be talking about and asking where something is, okay? So in English, like we say, where is this? Where is that, right? Well, in Ket, the order is reversed. So instead of putting the pronoun, the where is something like that at the front of the sentence, we put it at the end, right? So, or rather the question, we put it at the end. So if we say where, we say bising. Now let's take a look at this. I'm pretty sure that this B is some sort of interrogative particle originally, kind of like the English WH. Why do I say this? Remember, bitse, bila, bilangsang. This is our word for who, right? So I'm thinking that maybe this B could be something very ancient, something that originally a long time ago was actually a morpheme that denoted the whatness or the interrogativeness. But that's just my own hypothesis. I can't say that for sure. The other one we want to look at is sung. Now remember, wusang, bunsang. This looks suspiciously close, so I'm starting to think that the sung may be some sort of ancient morpheme for location or saying where something is. But again, that's just my hypothesis. I don't know that for sure. So, bising, where? Kissing, here. So remember, kire, kine for this or these, right? And tur or kar for things that are over there, right? So I think this is the same morpheme right here. Kissing, here. Kassing, there, over there. Now, here's the one I haven't seen, but it makes sense that there should be a tusing for a thing that's over there, but I'm able to point to it, I'm able to see it. Something that's far away, that's all the way clear over there, I would say kassing, right? So I'm not quite sure if tusing exists. If I were asked where something is in Ket and I wanted to say it's over there, I would say kassing until otherwise corrected. That's the way to play it safe, I think. But anyway, so let's take a look at an example. Now remember what I said about where questions, the interrogative comes at the end in Ket, right? So let's take a look. Ap tuyul bising. So ap we know is my, bising is where. So what's tuyul? Tuyul means, and this is important, it's a roundish birch bark container that is taller than it is wide. Okay, so and there are, this is very important. It's not just any birch bark container. It's a tall, thin birch bark container, and that's very important. We don't want to get our birch bark containers messed up in Ket culture. That'd be a disaster, unmitigated disaster. So that's, keep your birch bark containers categorized. So up to you, missing. So where is my tall, thin birch bark container? Ah, uk to you, kassing. Oh, uk your to you. Tall, thin birch bark container, kassing, over there. So your birch bark container is way over there, right? Now, we could also say, if we don't want to say here or there, we could also use a locative, right? So what if I want to say, oh, your birch bark container's at home? What would I say? Ah, I bet you can think of it by yourself without even looking at my whiteboard. What is it? Uk tayus Quska. That's right, very good. And so this is our final grammar point of the day, and now we're gonna move on to some vocabulary, okay? Okay, so for vocabulary today, we're going to learn about things in the house, right? And kind of household objects and some important cultural stuff too. So, listen and repeat after me. Alles. Alles. This is a female guardian spirit doll that is kept in a cat home. Alles. Dangles. Dangles. And this is another guardian spirit doll that is the male guardian spirit of an ancestor. And this is a little less common than an alles. Hoyang, things. Tick, furs or pelts. Suyat, clothing. Ongnis, bed. And made of skins, so it's the skins that you sleep on. It's not an actual bed that we think of, but it's skins that you sleep on. Usans, blankets. So literally usans, and remember us means warm. So usans is the warming one. Isn't that cool? So, tuyush, tuyush. Is, remember, it's a birch bark container that is taller than it is wide, okay? Ygit. This is a wide birch bark container. Koyush, pan. Tütün, kettle. Sütük, kneading trough. And the sütük is very important. It's like the classic food container utensil. So that's another thing that's culturally very much a big deal. Sütük. Bok. Fire. Ul. Water. Now let's do some adjectives. We already did one. Us, meaning warm, right? Sorry, that was my computer. Us, meaning warm. Let's also learn another one. Ang, ang, meaning hot. So us is warm, ang is hot. Now, if we know warm and hot, what's cold? Tai, tai, right? And there's one more that I want to talk about because it's in our dialogue, and that is tam, meaning or. Okay, so our conjunctions so far are hai, meaning and tam, meaning or. Cool. So let's go back to our conversation and see what we can understand. Ukungna koos kaahtas. So what's that? Ukungna, your koos, birch bark teepee, ka, big or very, achtas, good, or rather achta, good, plus s, one. So your house is the good one, or your home is the good one. Your home is very nice, right? So kutum, in response, says, eh, kuska usam. Eh, what's eh? Eh, of course, is yes. Kuska, what's kuska? That's right, it's the locative for at home, right? So kuska, at home, usam. Now remember our word us. What does us mean? It means warm. Now if we take an adjective and we put am on the end, what does that do? It means, it with an am at the end is like it is. So we could say kuska usam, it's warm at home. Right? It's warm inside. It's warm in the birch bark teepee. So we can respond, Ah, Quska akusu-san. So, Quska, we know, right? At home, akus, what? Usang, to be there, to be present, right? So, Quska akusu-san, what is there in your, what is there at home? So, Kutum can say, Quska idna hoyangu-san. So, at home, right? Quska, idna, our, hoyang usang. So, utn, right? So, at, maybe we can think about that. N, plural, na, possessive, right? So, udna is our. So, udna hoyang usang. So, our things there are, right? So, kuska udna hoyang usang. So, our things are at home. U, kire hoyang akus. So, kire, this, hoyang, stuff, akus, what? What stuff is this? What things are this? And really, specifically, it could mean what clothes are these, okay? Kutum, ah, kire tlek hai suyat. Kire tlek hai suyat. So, what is a tlek again? Remember, we said tlek means like furs or pelts, right? And a suyat means like specifically clothing. Specifically clothing. Hoyang can mean clothing. Hoyang, this also can mean clothing, but really it means things in general that belong to somebody. Which, of course, in the cat world is primarily clothing, right? Because it's so cold all the time, so you need lots of clothing. Anyway, tlek hai suyat. So, furs and clothing. Okay, good. Ture daha ningda kat. So, ture, that, daha ning, da. So, daha ning, belonging to. So, daha nings, right? Kat. Now, what is a kat? A kat is like a jacket, okay, or a coat. So, we could say, ture daha ningda kat. So, that is daha ning's jacket. Ture daha ningda kat. Hai kire ap usan. Kire, this, ap, my, usan. Remember usan, the warming one, the warming thing, right? Usans. U, tuneakus. What are those that we have right over there? Those, what are those? Tune, those, akus, what?
Kutum. Tune na alel hai dangus. Ukuska alel tam dangul susang.
Okay, that was a long one. Tune. So those, right?
Utna. Our. Alel hai dangles.
So alel, remember, is the female guardian spirit, right? And dangles is the male guardian spirit of a dead ancestor. So, the dolls or the small, and it's kind of trivializing to use our word dolls because that's a child's plaything, but these are actually very important ritual items. Guardian spirit dolls that are kept in the home. So, tune utna alel hai dangles. Now, so those are our alel and our dangles.
Ukuska alel tam dangles usang.
Do you have an alel and dangles in your home? So, ukuska, at your home, alel hai dangles, alel and dangles, usang, are there? Right? Now, let's stop for a second here, talking about the alel and dangles. Realistically, in cat culture, it's a little weird to be talking about them. Okay, so I'm being a little bit creative liberty here, but it's a little weird, slightly kind of taboo because these are very powerful objects. So you wouldn't walk into a ket kos and be like, show me your alel and dangles. That would just be a super, super awkward and bizarre thing to do, right? So I kind of tried to mitigate that by saying, what are those things, as if we don't know, right? But even still, it's kind of a weird thing to discuss. And so she asks us if we have this at our home too, since it's so weird that we asked about it, right? And what can we say? We can say,
Ab kuska alel tam dangles bunsang.
So,
Ap Quska, at my home. Alel tam dangols bunsang.
So, alel or dangols bunsang. There are not, right? So let's go through one more time.
Ooh. Akang na koos kaaktas. Ketum. Eh. Quska usam. Ooh. Quska akususang. Ketum. Quska edna hoyang usang.
Ooh.
Kire hoyang akus. Ketum. Kire tle kaisuyat. Ture. Daha ning da kaat hai kire apusang.
Ooh.
Tune akus. Ketum. Tune edna alel hai dangols. Ooh, Quska alel tam dangols. Usam?
Ooh.
Ap Quska alel hai tam dangols. Bunsang.
I just caught myself there. I always said that there is no alel and dangles at my house. But I should have said there is not an alel or dangles at my house.
So, ap Quska alel tam dangles bunsang.
Good job, everybody. That was a long one. Once again, go over to my blog at brofessorsoffice.blogspot.com for your homework. And I will see everybody next time. Take it easy. Bye, everybody. And as the count would say,
Kadok spanninga.